So good, you know this. So whoever not on this list, let us know. Because this is the public website. We want to make the visibility of the course higher, so we created this public website. And so your project will be on the website as well. We didn't wait for 5 minutes.
Facciamo così, io dopo una giornata di inferno oggi perché sto facendo il progetto per l'operativo. Però ci sentiamo, ci vediamo a freddo.
Volentieri, volentieri. Sì, sono
anche bene.
Io l'avevo visto perché noi lavoriamo sul Corriere dello Sport.
What have you got? Questions, answers. So, Tom, do you want to start first?
I don't have presentation. And I show only si gira qua che io il Mac non siamo molto. So unfortunately I don't speak a very good English, so I prefer to speak Italian, but sometime I will try to speak in English so to help. But my presentation in the site is in English, so you can look what I have done. A 18 anni ho esordito in Serie A perché volevo fare il calciatore e giocavo nel Milan, quindi tutta la mia infanzia è stata dedicata al calcio, quindi ho studiato pochissimo, ho fatto informatica perché era l'unica materia che mi permetteva di andare a fare gli allenamenti, e a 18 anni ho coronato il mio sogno, ho giocato in Serie A nel Milan e ho esordito in Serie A. Poi la vita a volte presenta delle sorprese, mi sono montato la testa, tutto quello che era il mio mondo fantastico è crollato dopo sei mesi perché non riuscivo più a giocare e non so spiegarmi perché. Quindi ho continuato a fare un po' di calcio naturalmente in categoria inferiore, quindi in Serie C, e dopo due anni mi sono rotto una gamba in maniera abbastanza pesante, quindi ho deciso di smettere col calcio e cominciare a fare qualcos'altro. Quindi mi sono trovato a 23 anni a non avere un background scolastico, ahimè, e non sapere fare niente. Quindi mi sono tirato sulle maniche e ho cominciato a cercare posti di lavoro. Il primo era a sistemare delle casse in un supermercato e via via. Ho sempre cercato posti di lavoro che mi permettessero di dialogare con la gente, perché la gente poi mi vedeva, riteneva che fossi affidabile e mi dava dei nuovi impieghi. Questo per dire che sono arrivato poi nel mondo della pubblicità nel 92 come portafoglio sviluppo in Manzoni Pubblicità, quindi gruppo editoriale L'Espresso, quindi Repubblica, Venerdì, L'Espresso e tutti i siti dei quotidiani locali. Quindi il mio, diciamo che la mia vita lavorativa è nata a 28 anni nel mondo della pubblicità. 8 anni nel gruppo Espresso, quindi una buona formazione in un'azienda meravigliosa dal punto di vista formativo, per arrivare intorno al 2000 a ricoprire comunque un ruolo importante che era responsabile di area Lombardia su alcuni settori come l'elettronica di consumo, le auto e la grande distribuzione. Poi ho fatto un salto e sono andato a fare direttore commerciale di un'azienda un po' più importante, cioè un po' più importante ruolo, meno importante l'azienda perché era la SPE, ma nel 2000 incominciava a nascere il mio amore per il web, quindi 2000, alla metà del 2000 sono andato a lavorare in Rai perché Rai aveva bisogno di un direttore commerciale per lanciare Rai.it, quindi sono arrivato in Rai, ho messo insieme una struttura di 15 venditori e abbiamo iniziato a vendere il prodotto della Rai che nasceva allora. Nel 2001, metà 2001, però lavoravo talmente bene che il responsabile commerciale della Rai, direttore generale, mi ha spostato a Mestre perché voleva che io prendessi tutta l'area dedicata anche alla televisione. Ma io non amavo la televisione e quindi ho detto di no e sono andato a lavorare in Virgilio come direttore commerciale. Virgilio all'epoca era la porta d'accesso al web italiano, in Italia c'era Virgilio e poi c'era tutto il resto, quindi per me era un'esperienza meravigliosa. Virgilio era un momento di crisi, arrivava dalle tutte arancioni, parliamo 2001-2002, ho preso in mano una struttura e nel giro di due anni siamo andati a break even, quindi 2004 abbiamo messo insieme una rete vendita di 18-20 persone, ho aperto le strutture sulle aree esterne e abbiamo risollevato una situazione che nel 2002 vedeva il mondo della pubblicità in mano ai loghi e le suonerie, che sono quelli che hanno salvato il web. Senza i loghi e le suonerie forse non saremmo qua, perché erano gli unici che investivano. C'era lo sboom di internet e quando andavi a parlare con le aziende ti ridevano in faccia perché si vendicavano di due anni di presunzione, di approccio poco epico al mercato, perché molti pensavano che il web fosse la panacea di tutti i mali e andavano a presentarlo come se fosse la rivoluzione. un bel bagno di umiltà, però nel 2003-2004 abbiamo cominciato a lavorare seriamente spiegando alle aziende cosa fosse il web e nel 2004 ci siamo tolti delle belle soddisfazioni. Nel frattempo io crescevo professionalmente e nasceva in me la voglia di fare cose diverse, quindi con un mio cliente che lavorava nei luoghi di suoneria abbiamo deciso in quel momento, acquistato da una telefonica importante che ha un nome in questo momento abbastanza discusso che era Otelli, abbiamo deciso di inventarci un prodotto nuovo. Nel 2004 ci siamo seduti a tavolino e abbiamo pensato di lanciare un nuovo portale che si chiama Leonardo.it. Leonardo.it è stato inventato, studiato, lanciato da me e altri pazzi, perché nel 2004 lanciare un portale in Italia significava andare contro Virgilio, il Libero, MSN, Yahoo, Fiscali e altri blasonati prodotti, ma ce la siamo sentita perché abbiamo studiato nuove forme di inventarci il web, perché cosa esisteva in quel momento, per dirvi anche quanto è importante cercare di pensare sempre un po' più in là di quello che il mercato rappresenta, cioè provare a pensare ai cambiamenti che voi vedete in quanto giovani e in quanto dentro questo settore. Il mercato vedeva un prodotto come Virgilio avere 200 persone che lavoravano sui contenuti editoriali che compravano da siti terzi. Grande home page con 1,8-2 milioni di utenti unici al giorno e prodotto veramente eccezionale. Motore di ricerca unico in Italia, poi acquistato in qualche modo pubblicitariamente, ma poi distrutto da Google, cioè da Google che è entrato pesantemente nel motore di ricerca di Virgilio. Noi abbiamo pensato che siccome i siti comunque avevano dei contenuti importanti, esistevano siti sul web di grande spessore, noi abbiamo pensato che Leonardo poteva raggrupparli tutti facendo dei canali verticali fatti dai siti stessi. Quindi il modello di Leonardo con uno stream header che aggregava i siti è stato quello di portare dei siti che in quel momento vivevano abbastanza bene nel mercato pubblicitario ma non erano così soddisfatti della loro concessionaria in un progetto unico che li univa per fare insieme una forza dirompente sul mercato. Quindi questo vuol dire che nel canale cinema abbiamo preso Filmappa, nel canale Meteo, Meteo Live, nella telefonia, telefonino.net, quindi unendo queste forze abbiamo fatto un portale che adesso fa 12 milioni di utenti unici e più di 400 milioni di pagine. Nel 2009 io stavo incominciando a vedere l'arrivo di una grande minaccia che erano i prodotti editoriali veri, quindi Repubblica, Corriere e tutti i prodotti dei grandi editori. Ho provato a parlare ai miei soci, non c'è stato molto ascolto e quando non è più possibile amare bisogna passare oltre e quindi ho deciso di fare consulente. Ho iniziato a lavorare per gruppi editoriali che mi chiamavano per riuscire a implementare e migliorare il loro traffico. Nel 2010 ho trasferito la mia residenza qua a Bolzano perché ho due figli piccoli, uno di 6 e uno di 4 anni, e con mia moglie siamo venuti qua a vivere, e da qua abbiamo iniziato parecchie attività. Quindi la mia attività principale è quella di prendere dei progetti che mi arrivano e stabilire se sono progetti che possono funzionare o no, fare progetti miei. Questa settimana lancio il 2 di novembre un progetto sui defunti e quindi poi vi darò l'indirizzo, perché è un progetto che seguo da 3 anni e sono particolarmente orgoglioso di lanciare un prodotto che non esiste nel mercato italiano. Faccio consulenza a aziende perché in questo momento riteniamo, e le aziende sempre di più se ne stanno rendendo conto, che c'è bisogno di un passaggio digitale importante. Se un'azienda sarà digitalizzata sopravviverà, chi non cambia il modo di lavorare e non andrà a lavorare col mondo digitale sicuramente avrà poco futuro. Di questo ne siamo estremamente convinti, io per primo lavoro con un team di persone che sono specializzate nei singoli campi. Quindi che cosa ho fatto io? Mi sono costruito una rete di collaboratori, prima di tutto collaboratori fidati, quindi le persone prima di tutto. In un momento difficile come questo, di crisi, è importante sapersi scegliere le persone con quali c'è feeling, c'è etica, c'è visione comune di intenti. Dopodiché, siccome ci sono dei costi di infrastruttura, è inutile andare a aprire SRL o fare mega uffici quando mai il web è liquido, quindi ho collaboratori in tutta Italia, anche all'estero, e so quali sono le caratteristiche di ogni collaboratore, per cui per ogni tipo di azienda ci sono dei professionisti che sono indicati per quelle esigenze. Fondamentalmente il messaggio che lancio è quello di veramente andare in profondità su qualsiasi cosa. C'è uno strumento meraviglioso che è il web, che è quello che ti permette di fare un benchmark su tutti i prodotti, e quindi nel tutto il mondo noi sappiamo esattamente chi ha fatto qualcosa, se funziona, quali sono i modelli di business, basta solo sapere andare a cercare nel modo giusto. Ma nello stesso tempo io ho fatto un prodotto come Leonardo dove mi davano 3 mesi di vita e invece ce l'ho fatta, quindi alla fine ci vuole sì molta, molta testa e molta lungimiranza, ma ci vuole anche tanto coraggio, che è dalla parola greca cuore e azione, quindi alla fine se uno crede veramente in quello che vuol fare ci può riuscire con tutte le cautele del caso, no? Quindi quello che metto a disposizione è 15 anni di esperienza nel mondo digitale più altri 10 anni nel mondo del media e della comunicazione e una grossa conoscenza di tutti i siti in Italia, quasi tutti, perché li ho visti con le loro verticalizzazioni, con i loro problemi, con i loro sogni e con tutta una serie di rapporti con i grandi editori per magari presentare progetti e anche a fondi sia istituzionali sia privati che a volte investono su progetti innovativi.
Grazie. For the people who don't understand Italian still, so I just try to recap what you. Yeah, yeah.
But you don't lose nothing.
Now, first of all, a message for people who have ideas related to sport, media, internet. So probably Fabio is the right mentor because if you got some numbers, he used to be a Serie A player for Milan, right? For AC Milan.
AC Milan.
Yeah. And so he started his career as a football player, really at high level. And then he stopped because of injury, knee injury. And he started work as in the domain of media and communication. So he worked for big newspapers like La Repubblica. And he also has 15 years of digital, so internet technology. So this domain. That's really a nutshell of what you just said. But you see, he speaks English, so if you have some questions, you can ask. I hope that you can answer. Yeah.
I try to answer.
Okay. Thanks. Who's next? Who wants to be next?
Robert?
Yeah, yeah. So. This one, no?
Yeah.
Johnny is a funny guy because his first name is more Finnish than we imagine. There's some secret history behind. I don't remember what that was. The Johnny guys, I have like million friends who are Johnny.
Okay. Thank you very much for being here. I'm very happy because every time I speak what I do, I'm speaking about what I've done, achieved, and then I hope that on the end of this year we can speak, fortunately, about industrial ventures and the startup we have funded. But let me start from something that is coming. There's something hitting the world of doing startups, and it's called hardware. Today, basically, is so fast and low-cost accessible prototyping facilities, so we can access technology that is cheap, we can buy it, we can combine it together, we can personalize it, and we can create a product easily in a few hours. So it's very easy to prototype, okay? It's very easy to create a product from zero. Also, it's very interesting because we can create new possibilities. We can produce and put together technology that validates something new that wasn't possible years ago. For example, these are rockets from NASA that was 3D printed. Also, we have the supply chain on how people address and access product and resources is dramatically changing. We don't need groceries. We don't need them more because we are going to an era where we can access on time, on-demand product, personalized product, ship it directly on your door in a few hours. So, the personal production. So, there would be more possibilities on producing what you need, when you need it, how you, on the way you need it. Also, there's an industry capacity that's not saturated. We have the possibility to produce new products because there's the infrastructure is ready.
What do you mean by saturated?
We have companies that have a gap between the amount of hours of machines they use to produce, between that time they use until the amount of time they could use. I mean, the possibilities. Because we see that economic crisis, financial crisis, economic crunch is seeing that industry needs new products. So this is very good because you have you can access with cheaper technology, with personalized production, you can access a platform, technological platform that can produce for you the products. And it's very ready to learn to know about your products and support you. So it's very good because the industry needs new products to produce. People need new products to buy and use. Also, it's coming very faster to go global. We see a dramatic development of platform, crowdfunding platform like, you know, Kickstarter, many of you know it. I think you know it all, okay? Yes? It's so fast. You can put your idea, giving some insight of what you have in mind. Speaking to the people, say why you do what you do. And you can raise money, you can validate your product worldwide in a few days, 30 or 45 days, depending on the campaign you build up. But it's very fast and cheap. Also, we are entering in an era where we have so emerging challenges, a lot of emerging challenges, from energy to agriculture and food to health, as climate change. So there's new emerging problems in terms of our ecosystem, where we live, our planet Earth. So this means a new opportunities to solve these challenges. So now I speak about what I do. I'm Yari Beni. I'm co-founder and managing partner of Industrial Ventures. That is one of the, basically the first hardware startup accelerator in Italy. What we do is that we try to find talent, people that have a product in mind. Basically, they have a ugly product in the hand that it works, but it's very ugly. This is our target. And we want to validate and support these people to produce and create the first prototype and go in the market faster and cheaper. What we are looking for? We basically are looking for this sector, these industries, these kind of products. So we look about hardware, not purely software products. So we look about hardware that mix technology, mechanics, robotics, something that really belongs to our heritage of Italian heritage. If you think that North Italy is the third best and most advanced technology platform in terms of industrial capacity in the world, after Japan and after Germany. So we are building up from a heritage, from a culture of doing great products, great things to put on the market. So what we have done since basically Industrial Ventures idea started 1 year ago, and we set up the company this June. And what we have done is that we try to put together three basic ingredients that we think are the key ingredients for making things happen. Capital, mentorship and know-how on how to do things, and tools. So, putting together these three ingredients, we set it up basically an acceleration program. So we started collecting projects from Italy and also Europe, but basically mostly from Italy, and we give to the selected startups that I will introduce you later, we give a mix between capital that can use it in cash and the budget development budget, access to mentors, and access to industry technology, industrial technologies. With these three mix of capital, mentorship, and tools, we basically make the startup, put the startup into an acceleration program. We want to make things happen faster and cheaper and understand as soon as possible if you have the right product in your hand and you can validate it right now on your target market. So what we do is that we work on acceleration program 6 months, basically. So we started from an initial assessment where we split the acceleration program into two streams and into two streamlines. One is about product. So we are focused on the technology, we are focused on the feasibility, we are focused on the engineering part, design, and quality testing. And other stream is focused on business. Do you have the right product in your hand? Are you targeting the right customer segment? Are you solving a big and multi-billion problem? And we go through three steps of 2 months each. Let me explain what we do in three steps. The first step is the shape step. We, on the first 2 months, try to answer the question, do we have a product? So, is it a product that I have in hand? Is it something that solves a problem? Is it something that has a functionality? So, this is the first question. And we go to an MVP. So, in 2 months, we try to build up a minimum viable product or a product that has a minimum feature set of functionalities that works. On the second stage, we ask ourselves, do we have a good product? So we work on pre-engineering, design, quality, and try to put out a good product, good shape, good materials that you feel good to buy it, okay? And we try to arrive to a final prototype after 4 months. On the next step and the final step, we try to sell. So we answer the question, can we sell this product? So we try to put in place the first customer validation, we go to the market, we try to sell a few pieces of the product and collect feedback and try to make customer relations. And we arrive at the demo day, and our demo day will be in end of April. What's secret sauce? The secret sauce is to mix together ingredients you can find on the market, like capital, mentorship, and know-how of people that do stuff, can do stuff, and tools, machinery. What we have put together is what I call a hardware development one-stop shop. So we put together in our space, in our laboratory, and with the external industrial partners, we put together an incredible mix of tools, machineries, that you can't even imagine to buy or use because they cost too much or they are not accessible on the market. But with our program, you can access it. So you can use some kind of technologies or instruments that cost a lot if you use it by yourself. With us, it's all accessible in one-stop shop. And you can use this kind of technology with our industry partners. What we do is that we basically are creating a space. This is a space that will be in Trento starting in November. And we have a mix between an office and a prototyping lab. So the people and the startup we select can stay together with us and they can basically meet the mentors, work with us on the development of the product and basically have access to tools and machineries of 3D printer, etc. What we have put together is an incredible mix of people that right now in Italy and worldwide are working on the technology and on hardware. So we have an advisory group from the ex-CEO of Pirelli Datalogic to Frog Design Executive Creative Director or people that work on semiconductor and microelectronics to mentors that work on the IP protection. They work basically on health and medical devices, or they work basically on great, incredible products like Google or the Orbit like the space rockets. And all the startups have access to these people. So what we did is that amount of capital, mentorship, and access to an incredible amount of people that can support them directly in our space or basically with Skype or wireless. What we've done since today is that we collected in this summer, we collected more than 50 startups projects in Italy, and someone was also from Europe. And right now, we are starting, 1st November, we will start our first class of our acceleration program. And on the end of November, first day of December, we will open up the next call that will be open up also in Brazil and Mexico. And then we are trying to go global with our model. And let me introduce the fact that on the 18th of October, we did our selection day. These are the people of the 8 selected team that were invited to Trento to our selection day. And we are in these days, we are finalizing our best 5. But I can say to you that we have companies that were producing agriculture machineries, they were creating drones technology, they were doing, I don't know, 3D printer, they are doing, I don't know, incredible powerful cameras. So people that do hardware, do technology, but they are missing the access to know-how, to people that can help them to create and accelerate on the product. Our next talk will start at the end of November and will end at the end of January. So we have this new call opening up on the end of this year. Okay, I want to close with 5 rules I can think are very important if you want to start a business or you are thinking basically to start a hardware business. So the one is that a real product is different than a digital product. So when you're thinking about creating an app for your iPhone is dramatically different to say, I want to create an iPhone. This is the target. This is the problem, that you are creating something that costs too much, costs a lot to produce, that has a quality to be tested. And this is that's something that you have to create it not just with your laptop or your code, but you need access to product, to technology, to facilities. So hardware products are different, but also hardware failures are expensive. So when you fail or you want to pivot from a digital product, it's quite easy. I have some experience, so you can spend a few hours with the team, or you can set up a new value proposition, you can access a new customer segment, or create a new business model on a digital product. It's different from a hardware. When your hardware is out, and to validate that the hardware is right costs a lot of money, but it requires a lot of, how do you say, also luck, because if you fail with a product, hardware is out, and you cannot pivot on it. Be Kickstarter ready. Every one of you, or if you have an idea to start a hardware company, or you have some technological in mind, keep in mind and work on Kickstarter. Kickstarter is a fantastic canvas. I can compare it with the business model canvas, something like that, because it allows you to put together all the information you need on your mind or your team to create a hardware company. So we can start already. And the other two are, first, go out as soon as possible with your clients. Our idea is that we try to mix and combine the lean approach of the digital with the hardware technology and the hardware startups. And the first rule is the customer validation. The customer validation means that if you have something in mind, go out and try to validate it. So validate it with your clients. And metrics. Metrics are very important in the hardware. Every startup we've met in our selection day, they have already product out. And they were very good to collect data about their product. How many times the people use their product, how they use it, downside time, or if they have a problem, in how much time they have solved this problem. So know your metrics. Your metrics in terms of how the people use your product and how the product can be used. So know your market, know where is your target, and basically know your numbers. Okay, I ended up. So you can find all information on Industrial Fund on Twitter or on our website. And I'm here for any question. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Actually, how many of you have the ideas? So you know whom to talk to now. Okay, any questions before we go to the next mentor? Go to either Gary.
Yes, please.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good question.
Oh, you want to hold for discussion section? Okay. So Lorenzo, please.
Okay.
Okay. Hi, I'm Lorenzo Cassula. It's my first time here at the Lean Start class. Last year, Pekka asked me to present some kind of real life experience on my own about entrepreneurship. So I've prepared a little presentation about me, and I put in it some of the tips that I've learned in my experience. So what about me? I started working with the web in 2006 when I graduated. I didn't like very much the job that I had at the time. I was working in a web agency in Turin, so I decided to start my own company. I do consultancy work. It's quite the opposite of what you have done in your life. I mean, I started as a consultant working with many different companies, basically most of them are startups. And what I did as a consultant was always deal with innovation projects related to new products or services or technologies. I work both in Italy and in US, and I've met a lot of companies, and I worked in a lot of projects. But I always wanted to, you know, come back to my home city, Trento, and I always wanted to have one of my home projects, something that I can feel something mine. So 3 years ago, I've met another entrepreneur. He has a big ICT group in Rome and Milan and London. And I talked to him about Trento, about how cool it is to live in Trento, to start a business in Trento, how many tools we have in Trentino to build a company. And he decided to invest in Trento, in Trentino, and start a spin-off of his company in Trento. And I helped the group, and I work there. At the moment, I help him to bootstrap the company and build the company from the ground up. So my experience in the last 3 years is not much, I know, but my experience is how is to build the company from the ground. We started 3 years ago, and it was me and one guy in an office, and now we are 10 after 3 years. So I went through a lot of trouble, I went through a lot of problems, and I put in this presentation some tips that I follow, some I wish I had followed, and some, but all of them, I would like someone told me about these tips before I started my experience. So just a few words about Xpressfans and about what we do. We are a software factory. We build software. Our markets are media. We have worked with Espresso, which was mentioned before. We work with Rai. We work with media company, and we develop for them digital products. We work with a telecommunication company like Telecom Italia. We have built the you guys know Dropbox? Okay. We build the same stuff for Telecom Italia, which is called the T-Cloud, you know, because Telecom wants to have his own cloud solution, and we have made that for them. A lot of boring stuff, and also we work with finance. Do you guys have the Bancomat, ATM? You use ATM? Okay, we have developed the payment gateway for the Bancomat payment system. The digital one, not the one that you use, but the one that is on the web, okay? And we are here in Trento. We also have a research project, thanks to the local government funding, which is focused on e-commerce, analytics on e-commerce, and multi-channel e-commerce, and some kind of, if you want to know more, you can just ask. The last stuff about me is that I love old-fashioned video games, like Super Mario. You know Super Mario? Yeah? Okay. I love pixel. I love, you know, annoying sounds. So I like to play 8-bit video games. Okay. This is a very few presentation about me and what I've done. If you want to know more, you can just Google me or go on LinkedIn and see my profile. I'd be happy to be stalked. Okay. I don't know if they are on topic now, because the other mentors really talk about their experience, and I give a little introduction, but I was prepared for something a little different, so this is what I've prepared to you. Basically, is all the stuff that I would like to someone have told me before start my experience with expectors and with entrepreneurship. So, I would like to share with you my vision of entrepreneurship and what is for me entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship, I think, is some kind of an act of reality. I don't know if it's the right way to say it in English. But basically, it means that the entrepreneur has something in his mind, has an idea, has something that he thinks is cool, and wants to share this thing with the outside world. And so entrepreneurship is when you put your ideas outside your head into the real world, and you confront the real world. You know, you make a connection between the real world and your head. And this is very difficult, because in your head, things are different than they are outside. And you are going to, you know, in this class, you're going to think about our business idea. You're going to develop the business idea. And then we will have the entrepreneurship night, and you're going to present your business idea to other people. And this is an act of reality. I mean, at the beginning of the class is something that is in your mind. At the end of the class is something that you will show on a board with your PowerPoint presentation. Okay, let's see what's next. So, the tips. First thing that I learned is that people are really important in business. People, not only your customer, of course, because customers is what are, you know, make your business go. But everyone you meet can have something to give you. And every time someone spends time with you is a gift, because they add more information to your experience, and then that allows you to confront your idea, you know, to measure your idea. And the first people that you will start to connect with in this class are going to be your teammates in company world, business world, are going to be your co-founders. So it's very important who is your co-founder or who are working with, because you are going to a lot of hard time if you are going to start a company. And my advice is to choose a co-founder to and when you choose a co-founder, you have to know that you're going to share a very hard moment. So be prepared, and also try to find someone who completes yourself, not a copy of yourself. Okay, it's very comfortable to hang out with people who are like are the same of you, but in company, in the business world, you need someone who complete yourself or has more value to what you are. So, okay, this one. Okay, and beside your co-founders, you have also customers. Customers are people who are you need to relate with. If you're going to, you need to validate your business idea, like Chiavi said. But nowadays, you know, old times they say know your customer. Nowadays you can know your customer, but you can also talk with your customers. You know, social media teach us that people want to talk. You know, people want to share. So don't be afraid to come to go and talk to your customer. You have a business idea for students in Bozen. Okay, if you spend time and go outside of school and talk with the students in Bozen. Your business idea is for restaurants. Okay, take one night and go for 1, 2, 3 restaurants and ask, hey, do you think this is a good idea? Hey, do you want this? I just think about this solution for you. Is it cool? And don't be afraid to do that. And you know, there's a big myth in digital industry that you just have a good idea and you put it outside. You know, I think this is this very cool iPhone app. I just put it on the App Store and I get 1,000 and 1,000 on downloads and I became rich and I don't have to do anything more in my life because I'm so rich about my iPhone. Okay, stuff like that doesn't happen. They talk about a lot, there's a lot of myths about that, but stuff like that doesn't happen. Even Facebook took a lot of years to, you know, became profitable and became something cool. So don't be afraid, you know, they say go out of the building, talk to your customer, please. And this is the best way to understand if your idea is good or not. Okay, next step, you will have a lot of, confrontation with other people, with your customers. And in order to be an entrepreneur, in order to start a company, you have to be stubborn, you have to be convinced about it, you have to believe in your idea. Okay, believe it, but not too much. I mean, there's a very tiny difference between stubborn and stupidity. So if you see that something needs to change, be prepared to change. This is a, you know, iterative circle. In Xpector, we do agile development for software, which basically means that every week we deliver a working copy of the software and we receive feedback of our customers from this working copy. And every week we can change requirements, we can adapt the software development. And Lean Startup is the same for business. So plan, you know, have your idea, create your idea somehow, an MVP, or just ask to one of your possible customers. See if your idea works, and if it's not working, try to understand why using metrics, for example, and adjust your idea, and then plan, do check and adjust again. So be prepared to change your idea. If you are doing all right, the idea that you had the first day of this class will not be the same that you are going to present at the entrepreneurship night. Okay, you have the idea, you know your customer, you are doing everything good, and you have your company is going very well. I'm happy for you guys. And now you have to hire people, okay? You have to find someone to work with besides you or your co-founder. And this is the part which I spend more time in the first, during the first year, is to find the right people. It's very hard, but if you can create a good team and you can work with good people, everything will go well. I mean, companies are made by people, and people hired in the company makes what the company is. And my advice is to set up a really cool recruitment process. For example, in Xpertware, we accept resume, or we always accept the resume, first of all. So we don't hire people for competence, but for what they are and what they want to, you know, if they want to grow, if they want to learn. We, for example, we have a little stupid technical quiz to solve in order to send us the resume. So we are sure that the people that send us the resume really want to give us their resume, and they also have some kind of technical experience. And as I said before, it's very comfortable to stick with people that are the same of you, but the most bold choice, and smart choice, is to hire people smarter than you. If you hire people smarter than you, you will have a company that you will never have back at home, okay? And, okay, next tip. Oh, this is cool, and this is something about life, not only about business. The only thing, the only resource that when it's over, is over, is time. If I run out of money, I can have a loan, I can spend a fee, I can do a lot of stuff. But if I run out of time, the time will never come back. There's no way to have back time. So be careful on and try to be as quick as possible. Because if you in the same time you can have multiple opportunities, if you are quick, you can catch them all. So be careful about your time, and remember that time is the only thing that when it's gone, it's gone. Another, this is tough. Okay, be prepared, because it's not easy. Building a company, being an entrepreneur, is very hard. There's a lot of bad moments, especially at the beginning. The bad moments are much more than the nice moments. But when you start your company, if you're doing it right, and you start to have a little more success, the nice moments start to become good moments, and then they became wonderful moments. And every wonderful moment worth all the bad moments that you have before. So be prepared, because it's really not easy. But I think that someone already told you about this. Okay, these are, you know, the stuff that I've been through in the last 3 years building Xpertware. And my last slide is about a little hint for you and for your business idea. It's not something so much, but we are living the worst economic crisis of the humankind. I think maybe the plague was worse than the economic crisis that we're living now. So my hint for your business idea is that if your business idea allows people to save money, it's probably a good idea, and you can and it's worth the time that you can spend on it. So this is my little hint if you want to follow. Okay, if you don't want, no problem. Just what I think. Then if you say, I think the most profitable business idea nowadays business idea that allows people to make money or time. Okay, that's all. And you can find me here. This is my Twitter. If you want to come to visit me in Trento, this is my address. And this is my company website.
interesting. Yeah, yeah, you already know Luigi from the case study.
I can use my LinkedIn profile. Okay. I'm a little younger, so I have not so much to say to you. I also was a football player in the third Liga, not in Serie A. And so when I was 18, I lost my knee. It was terrible. And I had to break my career. And it was really a bad period. So I started to study economics. And I decided to do a master in net economy. I had the idea that digital life has changed our way to live. And in this way, I started this master degree. And at the end, I also started working in TIS, Destination Park here in Bolzano. And my first tasks were to analyze businesses. Every kind of idea at the very first moment has to be planned, you know, the first job you did in all the chain. So I have to prepare business plans, business analysis, so try to understand what is the problem of an idea. 3 years ago, I started my new job, and is something like in the opposite part of EI, because he's a ventures, so private capital. And my work now is to find public capital for companies. You know, we have a lot of taxes in Italy, so we have the best in taxes, unfortunately. And we give a lot of money to Europe. So what happens with our money? So Europe gives the money back to regions, to all the states, to Rome, and also to Bolzano. And we have also the possibility to take this money and do something new. So companies can take money from Europe and build up projects. So that's called European project. But there is a problem. And the problem is the bureaucracy. And we have to put paper and paper again. Because when we use public funds, we have also to describe and justify what we are doing with this money, because our money for everybody. And I also did a master last year in how we have to ask money to Europe. So writing proposals, it's very difficult. It's like a business plan process for research and development projects. So we can go with the FP7 program, or in the future Horizon 2020, and also for local European programs, so the funds for the development of the region. And what is difficult is that most of the projects are going on people. So we have to combine people from these different countries and do cooperation projects. So this is the first in the quality of project at the moment, because people have to meet. And if I know that in Denmark or in Finland there is a possible partner, we have to work together, because Europe is not so big. We have to work together. So Japan, China, and Brazil, United States are very, very running people. And we have to build a team here in Europe and be more present on the global market. So this is my job. Try to find European programs to companies and also institutions, like, for example, universities, and try to do new projects. A project is like a new idea, you know. So we have to validate a project, we have to build up something, and then try to give a future to that project. So it's unusual to build a project and then break down and let's go. Okay? So this is my job. And also, you know, what's my idea, memory idea, so I told you last week. And this is a software idea, so not industry market. But of course, I think that also a software can be a new type of product. So I agree when you say that it's more difficult to build an iPhone, but I think that it's more difficult to change people. And people, you know, I am looking for you, you see you are always checking your email and what happens on LinkedIn, these are software, you know. And of course, industries and software has to be combined. Okay, so that's me. And if you have questions, you can find maybe here some references. No, I don't know. Otherwise, ask me. That's all. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you. I think what we are going to do is, before we jump into the discussion with the mentors, I'm going to talk about what's going to happen also for the sake of the mentors. So we have, because we some students start confused and say, do I have to create a video next week? Oh, going to present an idea. So we talk about this and also how mentors can be involved in the next days. So this week is Mentors Week. And next week, next Monday, from 10:30 to 12:30, is going to be the idea presentation session. So the students who have idea, who want to present, will present at that session. And what happened before that session, for the people who want to present an idea, is that you have to, first of all, create a video. Send us the link of this promotion video by Friday. That clear? Not everybody has to create a video, but the people who have ideas, create a promotion video, and the links will be sent to the mentors. You will watch the videos if you join the session on Monday. You watch the videos before you see the pitches.
Mm-hmm.
So we will forward to you all the video links. And to prepare this video, you can do on your own, but you already had idea how difficult to do on yourself. So from this 24-hour challenge. So if you want to go with another classmate, do it. Okay? So feel free to team up at this stage to promote your idea. But that team is not permanent. We will give students opportunities to join. So to vote ideas and to choose the ideas they want to work for the rest of the the rest of the semester. So this is the video. And then for idea presentation, you one thing you need to do beforehand, before you come to the session, is you create a poster. Because the purpose of this poster is to help the discussion, not for the pitch. You only have 2 minutes, so better don't use slides, don't use posters, just be here looking at the audience and present your idea. Try to convince this is really a brilliant idea. Because this is the moment you sell your idea and try to get teammates on board. So practice the 2 minute pitch. And the poster, bring the poster to you, and we will put in the open space there. And then afterwards, you will have time to explain in more detail what's your idea. So other students, they have questions, they can ask you. So that's the purpose for the poster. And don't spend too much time on poster. Don't print it out, draw by hand. So we give you a kind of rule of thumb, 15 minutes. If you spend more time, you are overdoing it. Okay, so don't spend too much time. And what happens after all the ideas presented, discussed, and we will decide what ideas to go on. So there will be a selection. But if you really convince your idea is brilliant and we couldn't recognize it because we are really not that smart, go ahead. And you can choose mentors and convince one or two mentors to go ahead with you. So the message is, even the idea is not selected, if you're convinced, go ahead with the idea. And we will do a kind of match between, we have 8 mentors. I think we will have more or less 7 to 8 ideas. So really what we can do is that each mentor can choose the best ideas you want to mentor. And you can choose the two mentors that you believe will. So the mentor will also work in pair. And the rest of the semester is that the mentors are going to follow the ideas development. So they're not going to fly to all the ideas and give just, you know, very quick comments. They are really going to take, in a sense, ownership. And you have to really make the idea of the whole team, not just your idea. So remember this detachment from your idea, right? Yesterday, one of the mentors said, try to detach it somehow and share it with your team. And there will be regularly presentation weekly. So we will, next week there will still be two sessions. So we will do team building, the new team building. We will introduce how team should work, how team should present the progress. After the next week, there are going to be only one session per week. We have to agree on which day, Monday or Tuesday. But that's going to be the demo session for all the ideas. You have to demo the progress. So what you did in the last week, yeah, to all the class, and then get feedback from all the class and mentors who are available to give the comments. So the weekly demo sessions will be the chance for the mentors to know how other mentors doing, how other projects ideas doing, rather than you go on the ones that you are mentoring. So we will provide opportunity to. It's really, you're more than welcome if you can come to this software, to this room to see the demo. But we will make video conferencing. So if you cannot make it, connect it to, yeah, and provide feedback through video conference. Yeah. And we will, today, we will register all the sessions. If you don't have time at that specific time slot, you can watch it later on and provide feedback to other teams. So, and I think Lorenzo already mentioned, and probably you already know, we will have this grand finale, the very big final of this is Entrepreneurship Night, which is going to be in January.
Oh, was it a surprise? Did I fall?
No. We already said several times. But you know, one message you have to say once, twice, three times, and then it may sink to the mind. So we remind people constantly. But all clear now. Yeah? So, okay. And now please, the mentors, if you want to sit around the table here, we can start the discussion. Oh, you want break 5 minutes, or students want 5 minutes break? We come back? No? Sure. Okay, so we switch off the, you can take 5 minute break, we switch off the